young boy who has demonic spirit, which is labeled here as a dumb spirit. As I looked at the passage and dealt with how these disciples dealt with this dilemma, I'm also reminded of those who consider themselves children of God, saved, sanctified, full of the Holy Ghost, but yet they have dumb spirit. In this area of evangelism, we can talk and praise God in church, but many times when you get in different circles, you get a dumb spirit. You can rag on God in prayer meetings, but a lot of times you won't talk about the Lord when you are on your job because you don't want to be embarrassed. You allow the devil to give you a dumb spirit. Today I want to deal with dealing with these kinds of spirits. How, if you're not careful, the devil can intimidate you into not being able to share the good news of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's see how Jesus handled this hour, and maybe when I look at how he handled this hour, I can find out what I can do to help me represent him in a greater and a grander way.
Yeah.
Are you praying with me?
Yeah.
I want to start off talking about the controversy and the crowd. The controversy and the crowd. You can say the crowd and the controversy. It doesn't matter because, you see, crowds are more than what they appear to be. Whenever you see a crowd, you have a little of everything in the crowd. Don't ever think that you see a crowd and you know who makes up the crowd. Crowds are made up of a lot of kind of folk. All kind of folk make up a crowd. Don't assume everybody in the crowd comes for the same reason. Don't think everybody that comes to church came to hear the word. Don't think everybody came to church came to praise the Lord. Don't think everybody came for the right reason. When you got a crowd, you're gonna have some folk in the crowd that has no intentions of trying to do the right thing. I have a witness here. And when they're in this crowd, there's this arguing and bickering. The crowd, and Matthew says, arguing and bickering. They're discussing. Because a lot of times crowds don't get along. If you bring up anything of meaning, any kind of meaningful position, you're going to find somebody who disagrees with you.
Yeah.
That's why when people go on first date, they don't talk about their politics. Because you see, if he tells her he's a Democrat, she might be a Republican. And she won't call him anymore. You got to be careful about crowds. So the Bible says that Jesus was coming down from the mountain. When you look at the context, Jesus is coming down off the Mount of Transfiguration. That's what Peter was talking about. He said, I'm going to build three tents. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. He wanted to stay on the mountaintop. A lot of us love to stay on mountaintops, but you can't live on a mountaintop. You see, a saint needs some solitude, but you got to be careful about living in solitary. Sometimes you isolate yourself so much you stop living, and when you stop living, you cannot properly represent God. When you lock yourself up, you don't know what's going on in the world. That's why it's good to know what's going on in the world. Look at the news, over the world. You can't just connect to God, the Holy Ghost. He's going to feed you on. You need to learn something about life. How can you witness the folk in life and you don't know what's going on around you? You've got to find out what's going on. Peter wanted to stay on the mountaintop, but you can't live in the mountaintop. And then mountaintop dwelling might be all right for you, but then you're not really helping anybody else. And that's what's wrong. We like to come to church and have our mountaintop experiences, but we don't do anything when we leave the mountaintop. You've got to spend some time in the valley. You've got to go in the crowd, go where the hurt is, go where they need some help and minister to those needs. They come out of the mountain and they see this crowd and they're arguing and bickering, and the discussion is really quite vigor. It's quite energetic. The scribes are excited because the disciples of Jesus has failed. The disciples have failed because a man brought them a boy possessed with a demonic spirit, and the disciples tried to cast the spirit out and could not cast the spirit out. Y'all better hear me today. Yeah, the world gets excited when the church fails. Oh yeah, look at what the man says, I brought him to you. But he really didn't bring it to him. He brought him to his disciples. Jesus was not there. And so they brought to the disciples because they didn't see Jesus. And you see, that's what the world is dealing with us. We claim we are followers of Jesus. So when they bring their troubles to Jesus, many times they're bringing their troubles to us. And y'all better hear me today. And when we don't deal properly with their troubles, they don't blame us. They blame Jesus. Y'all don't hear me. They fail. And when they fail, the scribes were excited. And the world gets excited when they think the church has failed. The world gets excited when they think the church cannot do what the church is supposed to do. Oh, they love it when they got some juicy gossip about a preacher messing with somebody he ain't got no business messing around. The deacon at the hotel with somebody he ain't supposed to be there with. Oh, we get all kind of juice. You can make CNN anybody. Ain't nobody going to talk about the preacher today. If you talk about the Holy Ghost came in Bethany and saved a bunch of souls, ain't nobody going to talk about the preacher today. You tell you that the Holy Ghost changed people's lives and they came out of darkness into the marvelous light. But oh, if you talk about somebody is messing with somebody else, that they supposed to be messing with somebody else and doing something to somebody else. Oh, we can make CNN right now, this day, before the sun goes down. Because the world loves controversy. Do I have a witness here? Oh, yeah, yeah. They brought the boy to Jesus, and the disciples tried to heal the boy, but they could not. And when they failed, the scribes had a field day. Yeah, 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 yeah. There's some folks who get excited when they have trouble in the church, and they love to just float around. But think about it. What about our evangelical stand? Why is it that we allow the world to label us as failures when he who we represent has all power in his hand? I mean, why did the man bring the boy to Jesus in the first place? He heard about it from somebody. He heard about it somewhere. Somebody told him about who Jesus was. Somebody told him that your son is in a bad condition and the doctors maybe can't do him any good, but if you bring him to that Galilean, that fellow from Nazareth, he may be able to heal him. He heard the possibility somewhere and he brought it to Jesus. Why is it when we don't do what we're supposed to do at first, we want to label ourselves failure? They're excited. And I'm just, it's really hard because the Bible says it's right at that point Jesus shows up. And when Jesus shows up, they are surprised. I don't understand it. If you were with Jesus' disciples, why are you surprised when Jesus shows up? Oh, y'all don't hear me. I just thought I'd throw it in there because, you know, a lot of folks get surprised when they see Jesus at church. Well, you come to church, this is God's house. We say this is all about Jesus, but you get kind of surprised when you see Jesus here. Oh, yeah, y'all, I expect to see the preacher. I expect to see some choir folk. I expect to see the deacons, but I really don't expect to see Jesus. Y'all better hear me today. Yeah, those folk ain't right at the church. I see those folks do a whole lot of wrong. You expect to see some gamblers, some liars, some hypocrites, but you don't really expect to see Jesus. I would contend that if you're going to come to God's house, maybe you ought to expect to see God's son. I mean, if you're going to come to God's house, maybe his son lives in his house. That folks ought to stop coming to church looking for the wrong folk. You ought to stop coming to church looking for what I got on and start coming to church looking for who I represent. It really ain't about Haynes. I mean, you really shouldn't call Haynes' name in church. You ought to be calling Jesus' name in church. I mean, before you leave, that's the name you ought to remember, Jesus. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Jesus the Christ. If you don't remember anything else, remember Jesus. Jesus, oh, how sweet the name. Jesus, every day the same. Jesus, let all saints proclaim. I don't know if I see the crowd, but I see the condition. I see the condition. The condition of the crowd and the condition of the boy. The Bible declared that they brought the boy to Jesus. I told you, he is possessed with a demon. He has a deaf and a dumb spirit. Do I have a witness here? They brought him to Jesus, and this crowd is in a mighty bad way. Because they heard about Jesus, but something is wrong, and Jesus puts a label on them. He says, "Oh, ye faithless generation." Right? I wish I had a witness here. He didn't talk about the condition of boy. In fact, the boy is demon possessed. He didn't talk about that. He says, "Faithless generation." Yeah. He says this after that he's told his disciples fail, and then many surmise he's talking to his disciples. But my question today is he really talking to just the disciples? I mean, after the evaluation, we find that the faithless posture is not just a problem of the disciples, it was a problem of the boy's daddy, too.
Yeah.
Y'all don't hear me. When he talks about a faithless generation, maybe it's not just the disciples that had a faith problem. In fact, we find later the faith wasn't really the problem with the disciples anyway. They had a praying problem, which is another sermon. But the fact is, the Bible says that he called them a faithless generation. Y'all better hear today. Maybe that's why people don't witness better. Maybe that's why we don't evangelize better. We got a faith problem. Maybe that's why we got so many dumb folks. And I said dumb, I'm not talking about intelligence limitations. I'm talking about dumb in your ability to speak. How many of you have forgotten how to speak out for the Lord? You're going to brag for your football team. You're going to brag if I say the Mavericks ain't about nothing. You get mad if I say the Cowboys sorry. You get all upset if I talk about the Texas Rangers. But how mad will you get if I say Jesus ain't about nothing? How mad would I get if I say pray but don't call Jesus' name when you pray? How mad would you get if I tell you you can go in the restaurant but don't call the name Jesus? Say your grace, but make sure you keep it low. Yourself. I don't want anybody to hear you but the Lord. Do I have a witness here? See, not to me, we ought to have some saints of God who want to just deliver ourselves from these dumb demonic spirits. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. There's nobody in here that really hasn't kept your mouth shut at a time when you should have been talking. Yeah. I'd be the first to admit I had some weak moments when I should have been bragging on the Lord, but I let my surroundings change my posture. Oh, when I was still young, I was young in the faith, when I wasn't as strong as I am now, I could let folk embarrass me into not taking the right stand. Oh yeah, when you're young, you're trying to impress some pretty little girl, you might, you know, deny who you are, whose you are. Oh yeah, y'all ain't gonna sit y'all looking at me like I'm the only one. Yeah, you told a whole lot of lies trying to impress some ladies at one point of time in your life. But when you get to a certain point in your life and the Holy Ghost in the New Testament. I said, well, if you don't believe in the New Testament, you don't believe in the Bible. If you don't believe in the Bible, I don't have anything to talk about. Because everything I talk about is based on the Word of God. So if you don't believe the Word of God, I don't really have a whole lot to talk about. I don't want to talk about all the other mess you want to talk about. Because see, to me, you want to talk about other stuff. Anything other than the Bible is what I call the wisdom of man. And the wisdom of man is foolishness compared with the wisdom. God, when he just joking around, is wiser than man is on his wisest day.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness here. So I think you ought to brag on the Lord. You ought to get rid of those dumb spirits and be ready to take a stand for the Master, because Jesus is worthy to be praised. Jesus came in that situation. He came there and he said, "You are a faithless generation." I want to ask you, how much, what's wrong with death today? It's because and you'll heal our son.
Yeah.
And he said, what you asking me to heal your boy for? You asking me to do what you could have done all alone. I don't have the problem. You got the problem. The reason your son is not healed is because your faith is not what it ought to be. Oh, y'all better hear me today. I'm going to walk here for a while because I think there are a lot of us who have a vision of Bethany that we haven't realized yet. And you think we haven't realized and you're ready to point your finger at somebody else. But I came out to tell you, maybe what's wrong with Bethany is your faith. Because your faith is not the faith it should be. Notice what I said. I didn't say you didn't have any faith, because I love the explanation of the old man. The boss said, I believe, I know I got faith, but he also was honest enough to admit there are some errors in his life that weren't what it should be. I believe, help thou my unbelief. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. See, what's wrong with too many folk? They're going around bragging on their strong points, and you got shall not prevail. Well, the gates mean we ain't supposed to wait for him to come to us. That means we ought to be going over to his house and attacking his gate. Y'all better hear me today. You got to be on the attack of him. I believe, but help thou mine unbelief.
Yeah.
And Lord, then he says something mighty powerful. Now, if you don't get anything else today, you make sure you get this. Jesus says, all things are possible to those who believe. Oh, that's the sermon right there. All things are possible. You see, you understand that there's really all kinds of possibilities if you just have faith enough to believe that God can make it possible. You talk about limitations in your life, the limitations you basically have set on yourself. Because if you have faith strong enough,